In chapter 7, we're going to discuss shock. There are many different things that we need to understand when we think about shock, because so many things can cause it. But one thing that we have to understand is what perfusion is. And that means that the body is getting enough blood and oxygen to all of the cells of the body. When we have something called hypoperfusion, that means there's not enough blood circulation, the cardiovascular system starts to fail and eventually ceases. There is a lot of damage that can be caused by shock. For the brain, it's in as little as 4 to 6 minutes, you can be damaged. The brain can have some damage. Abdominal organs take about 45 to 90 minutes, and the skin and muscle cells take about 3 to 6 hours to be damaged by shock. There's something called the perfusion triangle. And think of the circulatory system as having three parts. You have the heart or the pump, the blood vessels or the pipes, and then the blood or the fluid. So the heart pumps the fluid through the vessels. Shock occurs when one or more of the sides of this perfusion triangle are not working properly. So if the heart, which is the pumping action, is damaged by disease or injury, it cannot pump. Therefore, not enough blood is being moved. If the blood vessels dilate all at one time, then the amount of blood volume that's needed is not enough to fill the system, so there's not enough perfusion. And if we lose blood through any type of vomiting, we lose blood and fluids or blood loss from bleeding out, there's not enough to fill the vessels and support the perfusion needs of the body. So what causes shock? We have cardiovascular causes, meaning there's pump failure. This is known as cardiogenic shock. Pump failure can happen from a heart attack or any type of trauma to the heart. There's loss of blood or fluid, also known as hypovolemic shock or hemorrhagic shock. This means that there's not enough blood volume in the body. What can cause that? Some type of trauma to vessels or tissues, if there's too much vomiting or diarrhea. And then, of course, there's poor vessel function that can occur due to an infection or if there's a drug overdose or some type of allergic reaction like anaphylaxis and spinal cord injuries. If there's poor vessel function, you can go into what's called neurogenic shock, also part of cardiovascular issues. And then a combined vessel and content failure is known as septic shock. When somebody is septic, it's very, very dangerous and they need immediate care. So there are non-cardiovascular causes of shock as well. There's respiratory insufficiency, meaning there's not enough air getting through, and that could be from a chest injury or from an airway obstruction. Something is blocking the airway. It can be caused also by anaphylactic shock, which happens with the use of certain medications or food or insect stings if you have an allergy. For example, my husband's allergic to bees, so if he gets stung by a bee, he can go into anaphylactic shock, and he has to carry what's called an EpiPen that he can inject into his thigh that would release a dose of epinephrine to keep him going until, you know, we could get him to the hospital. But if he were to get stung and have anaphylactic shock, there are different signs and symptoms that occur in the skin, in the circulatory, and in the respiratory system. In the skin, there could be flushing or burning, itching, hives, swelling, discoloration, blue color or cyanosis, meaning there's not enough oxygen. The circulatory system can have a weak pulse. You could be dizzy or fainting. And in the respiratory system, the signs and symptoms would be a tightness in the chest with a persistent cough, difficulty breathing, fluid and mucus in the back of the throat and lungs, wheezing and stopping breathing. There's also psychogenic shock. This causes syncope. Syncope is the medical term for fainting. Sometimes that happens just because the person is in shock from fear or from bad news or unpleasant sights. The progression of shock is what we need to note, and Table 7.2 talks about the first one as being compensated shock, which is agitation and anxiety, restlessness, shortness of breath, nausea, thirst, paleness, feeling clammy, maybe having a weak, rapid heart rate. And then that can become decompensated shock, which is difficulty breathing, become ashen or gray looking or cyanotic or blue because you're not getting enough oxygen, and then the eyes can look dull and the pupils dilate. And then that could progress into what's known as irreversible shock, which obviously is the last stage before death. So that's part one of shock, chapter 7, and we'll finish in the next video on part 2.